19th is a Thursday. It is a day two, so you have to take a look at your schedule and you have to make sure that you are going to physically be around. It's going to be from 2 to 3 p.m., but it might go longer depending on technology. I had technology issues this morning, and we all know technology can fail, so you have to have a backup of some sort. The location here at Mossgrove. So all of the classrooms in Mossgrove are going to be in use. All of you guys are going to be presenting. The grade 8s through 11s are going to be dismissed early so that the entire school is involved in your presentations. Your audience consists of at least one teacher and about three other students, and possibly a community member, as well as any mentors. So you do have the opportunity to invite a mentor in if that is something that you are interested in doing. So I'm looking at you and thinking maybe you might want to invite John, right? So there's people that you might want to invite to come and celebrate in what you've done as well. Parents are also welcome to come and celebrate. It's really nice for a parent to be able to see, hear you talk about the accomplishments you've had over high school and your post-graduation plans. It's really a celebration, so think about that. It is a 5 to 7 minute presentation with a 3 minute question period afterwards, so each person is allotted about 10 minutes. It should be no shorter than five, it should be no longer than seven. The evaluation is a pass or fail with feedback given based on the content of your presentation and the delivery of your presentation. I'm gonna talk more about that in a moment. So, anyone in here, a district student, anyone have a special alternative schedule? If so, you are responsible for making sure that you arrange with your teacher or supervisor or whoever it is that you are here, okay? See me if you have a conflict and you don't know what to do about it and you need some help figuring it out. So see me right away, don't wait. Like, see me this week. So the requirements in short, so by the way, the piece of paper that you have in front of you in the handout, so take a look at that. It has a few things on there. So people tell me that I write too many words on things. So I've tried to not write too many words on this handout for you to make it really super clear and basic of what the outline is for the expectations of this presentation, okay? So use this. It has the details of it. It tells you what you must include. It talks about the reasons why we do the capstone presentation. And on the back side is the slide that you're actually going to spend the most time looking at, because this will help you outline exactly what it is that you're going to be talking about in your presentation. So there's three things we're looking at: the visual aids, we're looking at the content talking points, and we're looking at your oral presentation skills or delivery of the presentation. If you take a look at number two, the content talking points and structure, this gives you exactly what we need you to talk about during your presentation. So there it is right there. That's how you plan and prepare what it is you need to do. But as a review, oopsies, you need a visual aid of some sort. So what I have here is a PowerPoint. Remember, if you don't have access to PowerPoint at home, you can use PowerPoint on Office 365, right? So just like you logged on, log on and you have access to Office, Word, Excel, PowerPoint, everything. Also, you could do a Prezi presentation. Who has ever done a Prezi before? Has anyone done one before? Cool. So it's a kind of a really cool program, and it adds another element to it. So that's another option you could try out. But if you wanted to skip technology and do a trifold board or a large poster or some sort, you are welcome to do that as well, as long as it is big enough for people to be able to see what it is you're talking about. So those are options. As long as you have some kind of accompanying visual aids, you're good. Have some kind of a final presentation piece for your mini capstone, and this is going to represent that whole journey and the learning process. So that final piece of the mini capstone is something that I will explain in a moment. And the things you're going to bring along with you, you're going to bring an updated error-free resume, you're going to bring your updated action log, so please continue logging, you're going to bring a piece of evidence or an artifact, something that represents you, something that you are proud of. It could be a picture of said thing. It's just another element to show an insight into who you are and what you're passionate about. It may or may not relate to your mini capstone, depending on what your mini capstone is about. It can or cannot, doesn't matter. And I'll talk more about what that evidence is going to look like as well. That's a little bit more aligned with what student-led interviews used to look like and what they used to do there. They were asked to bring 2 to 3 pieces of evidence or artifacts. I'm asking you to bring one. So why do we do this presentation? Well, it's an opportunity for you to improve your self-confidence, okay? it's kind of nerve-wracking, isn't it, to think of speaking in front of a bunch of people about yourself. And I know that. But in the opportunity to do that, you are going to build your self-confidence amazingly, okay? It also builds your self-perceptions, and that's because you are asked to talk about yourself and to talk about what you're proud of and what you've accomplished. And once you physically are able to share that with other people, you really start to realize how unique and awesome you actually are. So it's a really great opportunity for that. Helps you reflect on your educational experiences, your post-graduation plans, so you're reflecting, you're articulating those things. It starts to become more real for you, right? You're still in grade 12, but it's nearing the end, so it's kind of exciting. Get that confidence in talking about your plans afterwards, gives your self-confidence as well. Develop your oral presentation skills. So really important skill for you to have is your ability to present orally in front of a group of people. So here is your practice. Demonstrate the power and importance of lifelong learning. So this is really one of the key pieces to your mini capstone presentation, is the understanding of lifelong learning and how you're going to be implementing that as you move forward. And lastly, it really does help you reflect on a goal setting process. You set yourself a goal. How did that turn out? How did that work? What is it like planning? What is it like making adjustments to that goal? When you set goals for yourself in future life, this is going to be a similar process for you. So to be able to reflect on that and say, well, this worked for me and this didn't work for me, is going to help you in the future. And it's all in a safe and encouraging environment, because we love you and we want you to succeed and we want to celebrate and all of the special things that you have done and are going to do. Okay, so this is really a safe place for you to take a risk and get the experience. Okay, Mrs. Dotto, what am I gonna present? What do I need to talk about in my presentation? Simple, an introduction of who you are. You're gonna talk about what you're proud of and show that piece of evidence that I mentioned, so something that relates to you that you're proud of. Talk about your plans for next year and the areas that you're interested in exploring in the future, so your possible career ideas. And notice how I'm very careful with how I word that. I'm not saying tell us what career you're going to pursue, because most people don't know what career they're going to pursue. You're still in the exploration phase. I want to know the areas you're interested in exploring, okay? And lastly, you're going to synthesize your mini capstone journey and learning. There it is. That's your presentation, those four things. Now, of course, there's more details that I'm going to get into for each one, but as long as you understand this, you can start to prepare for what it is you're gonna say. All right, so talking about yourself is the first part. When you come into your presentation, you wanna give your audience a really good understanding of who you are, but this is only about a minute or two long, okay? So in a succinct way, we wanna come away from that minute or two going, oh, that's who you are, that's what's important to you, and that's what you're involved in. So what can you talk about? Now, I encourage you to get out a pen and paper while I'm talking right now. You should be taking notes, because I guarantee you that after spring break, you're gonna be going, what did she say about that again? Or I don't remember this part or that part. So please take notes as you're listening along and write down the things that you know that you're gonna wanna be able to remember. I'm gonna post this up on the Facebook page. I'm also gonna post the PowerPoint up on the Moss Prep website. So it will be there available for you to scroll through again if you need to remind yourself, but taking notes is a good way to process information. All right, so talking about yourself. Well, you're gonna give a short introduction that may include anything that's important to who you are. So really think about what's important to you, who has made you who you are. How is your graduation year going so far? Oops, I missed one. Where do you come from? What is your story? Did you immigrate here from another country at a young age or well recently? Were you born and raised here? What is that history that has part of what made you who you are? How has your graduation year gone so far? Reflect on your last few years of high school. Even look at how you've developed since you first arrived. So think about you in grade 8. Was this any of you? Grade 8 to now, right? That quiet, kind of shy kid who didn't really know who they were, And over time you met friends, and over time you got involved in certain things, and you started to become and develop into the person you are today. Okay, so talk about that development. What has made you who you are? What significant things have contributed to you? What are your interests? So we want to know, what are you interested in? What are the things you spend your pastimes doing? What are your hobbies? The things you enjoy and are passionate about? Maybe you play soccer. Maybe you play an instrument. Maybe you collect stamps. Maybe you, I mean, what are the things that you do in your life that are important to who you are? Perhaps you're involved in some activities or sports inside or outside of school. Basically, you're painting a picture for your audience of who you are so that they understand the intricacies of what makes you uniquely you. And in setting the stage, can move on to the next pieces of that, because now the people have a connection with you and understand who's talking. Show pictures while you're doing that. So consider showing pictures or videos of yourself if applicable, giving us a glimpse into your life, adding to the visual aspect. So take a look. You might have some children photos of yourself. You might have pictures of yourself doing the activities that you enjoy doing. So if it's soccer, for example, maybe you have a picture of you on the soccer field or with a soccer ball. Or you can accompany what you're saying with the visuals, okay? Can you just take a minute right now on a piece of paper just to write down 3 or 4 or 5 things about, okay, that I'm gonna talk about this, I'm gonna talk about that, that, and that. So just jot a few ideas down. What are some of those things that you are gonna say about yourself? Right or wrong, it's all about 10 more seconds. I said a minute, but I really meant 30 seconds. All right, so any questions about the introduction piece? Pretty clear, kind of thinking about what you might say about yourself? As you move on in your presentation, you're going to move on to talking about some of those, the evidence or artifact that you have brought to describe something you're very proud of yourself. So what I want to see is something that's most likely related to something you're passionate about. It could be related to a challenge that you have overcome or a significant event that has happened that you've had to deal with, or something you've done that is related to your future. Could be kind of anything. There's no right or wrong for this. And like I said, this is more aligned with the student-led interviews and what kids used to be asked to do, is to bring in 2 to 3 pieces of evidence. But you're thinking about one aspect, something that you're proud of. So you're gonna bring in and show that evidence or artifact. It can be, so for example, if you are a musician and you want to show your violin, you can bring your violin in physically and show people, and this is the artifact, and this is your segue into talking about this passionate part of you that you are proud of. But you could also take a picture of the violin, or perhaps you could film yourself playing the violin to show yourself your skill in that area. You're gonna talk about why you're proud of this. So what is it about this thing that you've chose that you're very proud of? And why is it important to you? What skills does it show that you have? And if you can identify those skills, which is an important part, you can then lead into the next part. I'll give you the examples first. So examples of some of the things that you can bring. So I've taken photos over the years of some of the evidence that students have brought into student-led interviews. So it gives you a little bit of an idea. This is all available, will be available on the Mossgraph website, so you can come and take a closer look at some of the things that people have brought. But you can see dioramas, you can see awards, a robot that somebody bought. Somebody brought in their bicycle wheel because that was something that was really important to them, is their cycling. A jersey for a sports team. So it can be a personal memento of some kind, which we see there as well. It could be something academic or school related. You know, maybe it's a report card you're super proud of, or a math quiz or test that you worked really hard on acing. Maybe it's something related to your future goals. There's no right or wrong. Come back to this PowerPoint and take a look and help to think about what it is you might want to bring, but here are some more pictures of evidence examples. So we have people who bring awards for things like principles list, okay? This is important to this person because it's part of their heritage, so it's a dream catcher. So maybe it's something that represents just an important part of you. A project that somebody completed, craft things, sports memorabilia. Of course, there are so many wonderfully artistic, creative students here that we see lots of amazing paintings and art products there. There's another painting there. Could be a music composition. Could be inspiring books that really have guided you, that you really take inspiration from, or you know, anything that is important to who you are. Mm-hmm. And when you talk about this thing that you're very proud of or passionate about, this is just an example. You could always show us a piece, as I mentioned, if it was an instrument, for example. You could always show us what that might look like. I thought this, it wouldn't be from when you were seven, like this little girl. It would be from something more recent. But here's an example of somebody showing their skill, and she's pretty amazing. Pause it there because I don't want to scare you too much, but you don't want to mess with this little girl if you meet her on the street, that's for sure. But yeah, you could show a video of something that you're involved in, just like that. Can I get to the next slide from here? Nope. Need to close that maybe. Oops. Okay, so just take a minute, which really means 30 seconds, to write down what you might bring as an artifact or a piece of evidence, or what you might talk about. So what is that thing that you're kind of proud of that really is part of who you are? Somebody asked me this morning, they said, I was involved in something for most of my life. It's really important to me, but I'm not doing it this year. Is it okay if I show that? Yes, it is. So kind of like, if it was from grade 10 and before, I would say that's probably a little bit too old. But if it's something from grade 10, 11, 12, even if you're not doing it this year, but it's still important to you, yes, you can talk about that. Okay, so you should be jotting down what you think you might bring, or a couple ideas of what it is you might talk about. So I mentioned when you talk about this piece of evidence or this thing you're passionate about, you're going to talk about the skills that it shows you have. And when you're doing your presentation, you need to find the transitions between what you're saying into the next topic of what you're saying. So one of the really good ways to transition into the next part, which is talking about your future plans and your goals for post-graduation, is linking the skills from that evidence to how those skills are going to contribute to your post-graduation plans. So that's a really good way to segue into the next part. And you're going to be talking about this, and it's straightforward. You know why? Because you've already done this for me. You did this in your transition plan. You wrote three paragraphs, gave me an idea for what you're doing post-graduation. Some people put more detail in it than others. If you didn't put a lot of detail in it, you're going to want to flesh it out a little bit more. And you're talking about what your education, work, volunteer, and career goals are. So we're not expecting everyone to come in and to be saying they're going to university, for example. We know that there are different plans for different folks, and every plan is a good one. So whatever unique plan you have, so whether it be going to work next year and making money and gaining skills in the world, or going to college, or going to university, or volunteering, whatever it is that you are doing, it's good plans as long as you have a plan, okay? So don't feel pressure to present a certain type of plan that might have a, you know, a certain reputation attached to it. That's not what we're looking for. We want to know that you've made unique plans for yourself. So tell us what you see yourself doing next year. Give us all the details. What is that going to look like? Tell us about the areas you're interested in exploring. What career areas have caught your interest so far? Notice how I word this. I'm wording it because I know that you don't know exactly what you're going to do when you grow up, but that you are exploring areas. Some of you will be going directly, oh, I already said that. So yeah, last point. Okay, and that's kind of like it for the future plans and next year. You've kind of done the pre-work for that. You've started to talk about, hey, and you might have changed your mind, right? Some of those things that you wrote in your transition plan might be different now. That's okay. You just talk about how they've changed and what your new plans are. Okay, and from there, you're gonna move into reflecting on your mini capstone journey. So this is kind of the biggest part of your presentation, is talking about that mini capstone journey. So first of all, you need to make sure we understand what is the original goal and the original question that you set out to explore. What kind of action steps or goals did you set for yourself? And then you're just gonna tell us how that went. So some people might feel like so far they've miserably failed at their goal, and that is okay. You're not gonna fail the presentation for feeling like you failed at your goal. If you can talk about what happened and what did you notice about that, how can you improve in the future, that is the main thing that we're looking for. So are you able to reflect on what went wrong and make it better next time? So basically, I want you to show us where you started. I want you to show us a bit of what happened in between, like what are the kinds of things you did towards your goal. And then you're gonna show us your final piece. The final piece I will touch on again. I'll give you some examples of what that's gonna look like. But we wanna know where you ended up. And if you didn't achieve your goal, that's okay. You're gonna talk about how far you did get, and you're gonna show us how far you did get and talk about what else would be left and what else you plan on doing. Maybe you're like, I realized I didn't like my goal at all. So I got this far, this is what I did, but I'm kind of done with that now and I'm moving on to other things, and that's okay. Because that's part of life and that's part of what happens. So did the goal or question focus change over time? Explain why. What did you learn? What did you accomplish? What were the challenges? How did you overcome them? And then showing your final mini capstone piece. This is a big part too. The reflection piece on how you've demonstrated your ability to be a lifelong learner, or not demonstrated your ability to be a lifelong learner. But then in that case, you want to be able to identify, what do I need to do to be a better lifelong learner? And I will talk about what being a lifelong learner means. So when I talk about the final mini capstone pieces, you have to think of, what is that final thing that I can show at the end to show where my capstone went to? So there's, from what all the grade 12s decided to do, I've kind of collated them into like 6 or 7 kind of categories, and I'll go through a few of those categories and give you some examples of what your capstone final piece might look like. So if you were one of the people who decided you were gonna learn a brand new skill, what I want you to do in their final piece is to demonstrate what your skill level is now. So you wanted to learn a skill, so show us, how far did you get with that skill? What does that look like now? If you were learning a language, for example, there was a ton of people who wanted to learn a new language or the basics of a new language. Basically, I want you to demonstrate what you learned. Some examples, so maybe you're showing a video of you having a conversation. Maybe it's you speaking the language for us. So right here, as you're doing your oral presentation, perhaps you're demonstrating your new language skills. Maybe you're playing an audio recording, or you're being creative and you're creating a short video of you using the language skills. It could be in a real or a fictitious setting, depending on what you want to do. So these are some examples of how you could show that final piece. Here is an example of a girl who learned Korean in her grade 12 year. Don't be intimidated. I don't expect your skills to be this good, but it's really cool.
안녕하세요. 알바 K-뷰티 안젤라입니다. 요즘에 많은 구독자님들께서 제가 한국어로 말하는 영상을 보고 싶어 하셔서 이제 한국어로 영상을 찍을 거예요. 그런데 처음이라서 좀 긴장이 되긴 하는데요. 그래도 이쁘게 봐주시면 감사하겠습니다. 오늘은 제가 한국어 공부 경험에 대해서 얘기할...
Okay. Does anyone speak Korean? Are you Korean ever? What are you? Not Korean? Okay, so anyway. Sounds pretty good, right? I don't expect your language skills to have developed that much. this girl actually did it on her own. She was like in her grade 12 year, she's like, I just want to learn how to speak Korean. And so she spent a lot of time learning how to speak Korean. As you can see, she was very successful, but she would get in trouble from her mom because her mom would be like, go do your homework and stop learning Korean. So there's an example of what you can do to show your skills. Of course, you probably are not that advanced, and that is okay. All right, if your goal was to create something, so maybe you said, hey, at the end of this, I want to be able to create something. Of course, the finished product is showing us what you've created, or how far you got with that creation if you didn't complete it, right? So you might show us your final art piece, or show us your final video that you created, or show us the animation or game design, or the coding sequence that you created. You might show us your final art portfolio. Some people were doing a fashion line or cooking meals. You can show us pictures of the final meals that you cooked. You just have to pull it together and show us what you did. That makes sense, right? So here's an example of somebody who created an animation video showing us what they've created. It's amazing though, the emotion that they can give to like a bubble character. Like you really feel that he's sad, right? It's pretty amazing. Okay, here's another one. If your goal was to improve your knowledge or understanding of something, so maybe you set out to understand something more, to get more information about something, then you need to show us your research somehow. So show us what you now know, what you now understand about that topic. So for example, if you were researching career and post-secondary options, you're going to gather all the information that you learn and you're going to be able to show us that somehow. It could be in part of your PowerPoint or, you know, a collage of some sort or a series of photos, whatever it might be. You can put together a slideshow about the details that you learned. You could even be so far as to be creative and do a spoken word that highlights what you've learned and what you now understand. You could create a video or a vlog or interview of yourself where you talk about your new knowledge and how you got that new knowledge. So lots of options and opportunities. These are just suggestions, some of the things. This is an example of somebody who's put together some photographs and memoirs of their family's heritage because they set out to learn more about their heritage. So you can watch that online as well. Another category, lots of people wanted to do something that was sort of going to better themselves, make them better somehow, or to improve something for themselves. And basically, you have to show us how you've done that. So if you've done something like that, just show us how have you done that and what strategies you used, okay? And did they work? Reflecting on whether or not they worked. So for example, you might show us your research and what you know about improving your time management skills, for example. Show us what you did to improve your time management skills. Maybe you're going to do a top 10 list of strategies and give us your feedback on each one. Maybe you're going to show us the before and after pictures if you set a fitness goal. Show us the before and after pictures, or your abilities before and your abilities now. Maybe it's performing a spoken word that highlights what you learned, the same as the other one, or what you now understand. Or creating that vlog, talking about how you improved yourself. Or even being creative and doing a short story about the little girl who wanted to eat better and read it out loud to the audience. Who knows? There's so many possibilities that you could do. But your final piece will just showcase where you got to. Any questions about what the final piece is going to look like? So if you want to take 10 seconds right now and just write down your idea, what do you think you're going to do? Just write that down. Some of the ideas that you heard might have sparked something for you. He says 3 weeks before. Okay. And what I have here is some examples of various capstone projects being done across North America. And you can see some of the capstone things that students have done. Don't be intimidated. Yours was arranged as a mini capstone, remember, and these are more dedicated, they have more dedicated time to them, but gives you a cool idea of what some people have done, how they talk about it. That was like a commercial sounding there. All right, so I'll just show you a little bit of this and then you can watch the rest on your own.
And I hope to give the books out to soldiers and veterans in VA hospitals battling PTSD and traumatic injuries.
I'm Jenna Pethybridge, and for my senior project, I made a comfort food cookbook. So in the beginning of the year, I went online and I found recipes that I thought fit along with the theme of my book. And then about every week or so, I would cook a recipe and then take pictures of the food that I cook, and then I put it all together in the cookbook. And if there was something about the recipe that I didn't like, I would edit it or change around the words. And yeah, that's that. It was very fun. I got to eat a lot of food. It was really delicious. And yeah, I learned a lot about cooking, and I now feel very comfortable cooking in the kitchen.
Okay. So you can finish watching those on your own if you like. I've got two more videos here you could take a look at. It's always interesting to see what other people do and how they talk about it and that kind of thing. Now, they're talking about it in a more casual setting. Their setup is different than ours. Ours is more of a formal oral presentation. I'll talk about dress code and all those kinds of things as well. So I put this up here because I like this 101 ways to show what you know. And this is just sort of some ideas of if you want to be a little bit creative and you want some ideas of how to be creative, there's 101 ways, okay? I mentioned to you that lifelong learning is a really important part, and reflecting on your ability to be a lifelong learner is an important part of your presentation. So you need to understand what being a lifelong learner means, right? So that's the definition. Lifelong learning is the ongoing, voluntary, and self-motivated pursuit of knowledge for either personal or professional reasons. So the key word in here is self-motivated. So you were given a project at the beginning of this year, and you were asked to follow an interest or something that was exciting to you, and you were left alone to complete that project. So what you need to look at is, how is my self-motivation? Were you able to self-motivate yourself to complete? Are you used to people breathing down your neck and poking at you, reminding you to do things? Is that the only way you get things done? If so, please reflect on that and think about it. And if that's what happened during this process, as long as you can reflect on that and try to figure out, how would I change that next time? How would I improve? What do I need to be self-motivated? If you can identify those things for yourself, you're going to be more successful in future in life, okay? So reflecting on your ability to be a lifelong learner and what that means. Learning for learning's sake. This is going to help you in university and in life. It's part of real life, right? When you think of school life, your teachers and how much we coddle you and how much we try to motivate you with different strategies, that's not real life. So you've got to figure it out how you're gonna get that self-motivation. And like I said, is this the first time you've ever got a project without somebody breathing down your neck all the time? It might be, right? So you kind of had to figure that out, and how are you gonna deal with that? So how did you do with it? If you didn't do well, the big piece is you need to own it. Own it. And figure out what went wrong and how it's gonna improve. So here's my example down here. I am career programmed, so I see all of you guys, and I understand you talk to me about what your future interests are. And I've got a ton of kids who are interested in going into game design, for example. Now I've got two categories there. The one that's interested in game design that has gone on the internet and done research and learned some programs and learned how to code and talked to people and looked at examples and has some skills because they built them themselves.
And then there's the one who says, I want to be a game designer and hasn't done anything to learn about what that means to be a game designer. So we're talking about the ability to self-motivate yourself to be a lifelong learner, to gain the skills you are going to need to get yourself ahead of the game or in the game at all. Okay? All right. Whoops, I went backwards. So here's another example, lifelong learning. Have you guys ever heard of bloodletting? It was an ancient practice that they used to do, doctors, and actually barbers used to do this because the barbers had all the equipment that they needed. But if you were sick, they believed that if they cut you open and let your blood drip out, they would cleanse you of your sickness. So if we didn't keep on learning and keep on asking questions and keep researching, we might think this still was a safe practice, which we know it is not. Our doctors don't just go to med school and then go to work. You're working as a doctor, you need to be reading research, you need to be going to workshops, you need to be understanding new medical enhancements, you need to be understanding how things are changing in the medical world. So it's a lifelong learning process. You're going to bring your resume, you're going to bring your action log, you need to make sure they're both updated, and you need to make sure that your resume is error-free. Here's me marking your resumes. That was me yesterday. I was like, woohoo, paper everywhere. No, I spend so much time giving you feedback on your resumes. It's really sad if you get it back and then you don't actually take into account my feedback. So I want to make sure that you do that, and when you bring it in that day, it's looking solid and sharp. So when you graduate from Muskrat, you guys are going to steal all the jobs away from everybody else because you'll have the best piece of paper to represent you. All right, the other thing we're going to be looking at in this presentation, obviously, is your oral presentation skills. So time management is important. No less than 5 minutes, no more than 7 minutes. Note cards may be used, but note cards should not be read off of like this. You could be something that just helps you keep on track, okay? Good eye contact. So notice while I talk to you guys, my eyes are scanning the audience across the room, and I'm trying to make a connection with all of you as another way to try to keep you engaged. Be appropriately animated. Gestures, moving around a little bit, those are interesting things versus standing in a straight solid line like this and doing your presentation kind of like that, okay? Speaking in a clear, audible voice. This is going to be a struggle for most people, I know, because it comes with confidence, but it's really important that as you're speaking, we can hear you. Use good language skills and pronunciation. Communicate your information clearly. So work it out beforehand. You're going to be practicing your presentation to make sure you have the best way to say it. And speak in a poised, controlled, and smooth manner. Which means if you're really nervous and you're tempted to talk really fast and you want to talk through your presentation, you have to be able to take a breath, slow yourself down, and make sure you're maintaining a good pace. All skills that you're going to need in the future. But most of all, I do want you to have fun. And I know you're thinking, Mrs. Datto, seriously, fun? This is nerve-wracking. I'm nervous. I know, but you're going to be in the preparation stages before this. You're going to be preparing for it. And after it's all done, you're going to walk away from it going, was not as bad as I thought it was. And so often after student-led interviews and kids have had a chance to come in and share with somebody who they are and celebrate themselves, they walk out with smiles from ear to ear because they feel so good at having been able to celebrate themselves and articulate with somebody else all those special things about them. You will feel good, not only because it's done, but because you'll be proud of yourself. Okay, it's really your opportunity to shine and be proud. All right, the most important part, right? This is the part you've been waiting for. This is what everybody wants to know about, the dress requirements. So what do you wear? It is a business casual dress code, which means no jeans or runners. Do the best that you can. There are people who do not own a pair of dress pants or a pair of dress shoes, and it's difficult to go out and buy those things. Think about borrowing. I also have some items in my office that I can lend. I have dress pants for guys and collared shirts and stuff like that I can lend out. Open-toed shoes are a no-no. Extremely high heels, ladies. Don't be that person like I had that year in the student-led interviews that bailed on her face as she was walking into her interview because she was wearing 5-inch heels.
Don't be that person. Sweats, hoodies, those things are no-nos, but what are we saying yes to? Dress pants, skirts, ladies, collared shirts, suits, ties, any plain type sweaters or cardigans are fine, or like polo shirts, blouses like the one I'm wearing today, dress shoes. You do the best that you can. We can tell if you've made an effort. I'm not requiring you to go out and buy a suit and tie and tell your parents that Mrs. Dado said you need to give them $500 or whatever. You know, no. But do the best that you can, okay? So what is business casual? Well, this chart gives you a really good idea of the difference between business professional and business casual. What's the difference? Well, just the difference. I can see you're thinking it, Allie. You're just like, what? What's the difference?
The difference shows you.
I know, but what do you notice between professional and casual?
Professional is more professional than casual.
Nice. Yeah, it's black. But yeah, I guess when you're in a more business professional setting, color is pretty simple. But doesn't mean you can't wear color. But the biggest difference you'll notice is that we have a matching blazer and pants versus a dress pant and a random collared shirt or that kind of thing. So that's kind of the difference between professional and casual. Now, many people do come in business professional. So it's between business casual and business professional. So you can decide for you what works. But you do not have to have a suit and tie, dress pants, dress shirt. So if you want some other options, guys, there's khaki pants, corduroys, chinos, dress pants are all acceptable types of business casual type pants. If we were to take a look at this lovely lady and her interview look, how could we improve this look? Any suggestions to make it a little bit more professional? Wakey, wakey, snakey. What do you think? It's perfect.
Yeah.
Who thinks it's perfect? You're either alone or everyone else is so scared to either make eye contact with me or make an answer that they're not saying anything. Fine. Well, how about this? So a little bit of a change. So you notice she's wearing more of a t-shirt, so maybe updating that to a bit of a blouse. Her shoes are cute, but might detract a little bit from her. So I would go maybe with a simpler pump kind of thing. So heel is okay, but it should not be too high and should not pull attention away from you. People shouldn't be looking at your shoes going, is she going to fall? How about the skirt? Well, yes, we do need to lengthen the skirt a little bit more. She looks great, but in a professional setting, the skirt should be longer. Okay, something that is more comfortable for you to move around in that won't be too revealing. So the general rule of thumb is if you take your three fingers and put them above your kneecap, your skirt should touch your fingers or be below. And that's kind of looking more at the professional type length, okay? All right, here are some past interview outfits that people have worn. So you can take a look at the Muskrat website and kind of get yourself some ideas for what you might dress up in. Okay, any questions about dress code? Look alive, people. Evaluation, how are we evaluating you? Well, it is a pass or fail. There's many reasons for that. You can't put a number on something that is so subjective in terms of something that is important to somebody that is celebrating them. How do you put a number on that? But there is criteria that you do have to meet in order to pass. Will you fail? I can say 99.9% positive that nobody will fail at all. So I know you guys will all put in a good effort. You all do a great job, and that should not be an issue, but you will get some good feedback on how you can improve in your oral presentation skills for the future. So we're looking at visual aids. Do they enhance your presentation? Content, have you thoughtfully and thoroughly discussed all of the talking points in your presentation and your actual oral presentation skills? Are they strong and clear throughout your presentation? This is what the evaluation form is going to look like. This rubric is available on the Muskrat website if you'd like to take a look at it. You can see what makes you an excellent presenter. And I will remind you to please access your mentors. Remember we had you identify a few mentors that would be supporting you throughout? Have you used them? Have you talked to them? Have they been supporting you? Hopefully they have. Don't forget to access them as you go through this process and get some advice and feedback from them. And also, you have the opportunity to invite them to your presentation. As I mentioned earlier, you just need to notify me. It's a really nice thing to invite your parent to because they have an opportunity to hear you talk about how you've grown and where you're going after high school. And I know as I'm a parent, I would love to celebrate in my children's success that way, and I just think it would be a great thing. So you have the option to invite them as well. And that's me. Come ask me for help anytime. I'm in 313. If you're confused, you have questions, you need help thinking through something, just get a hold of me and use me as a resource, okay? And on the MOSGRAP website, you'll get rubric criteria, video links, examples, all of those kinds of things. Are there any questions for now? So do you feel like you kind of know what you're up against here and what you need to do? I'm seeing some nodding heads. I'm hoping so. But if not, watch this PowerPoint again and then come see me. Now, what do you do now? Take a picture of this or write these things down because this is kind of like what you need to focus on in the next few weeks. You need to arrange to be here on April the 19th, period 5. You need to choose your presentation style. How are you going to present? What are your visuals going to look like? Gather the documentation, examples, evidence, the photos, the videos, everything that you're going to be using. Create or perfect your final mini capstone piece. Plan what it is you're going to be saying. Complete the final action steps for your mini capstone. Oops, I thought I moved that. That should be up here. So yeah, anything left? Anything left for your mini capstone or that you feel like, okay, I didn't get as far as I wanted to, but there's one more thing that I feel like I could do or I could try? That's what you're gonna be doing in the next few weeks. Reflect and check the MOSGRAP website. So that is your next steps. Remember that if you're using technology, technology can fail. You want to have backup. USB drive, okay, and save everything on there. Lastly, I will post the schedule after spring break, but I will also come in the second week of April to your English 12 class, and if you don't have English 12, I will set up a side like this, a time where you can come and check in with me, and I'll come into your English 12 classes just briefly to hand you back your transition plans and to also answer any other questions that you might have. Be free. Celebrate. Think about how you're going to celebrate yourself. I look forward to all of them. Okay, so you can stay and study or you can go and... Oh no.